Well, Merry Christmas. Good evening. We are super happy you guys are here to worship and glorify our Lord and Savior this morning, this evening. And why don't you stand and join with us? Shepherds wondered, they couldn't hide it. Told everyone in sight. All were amazed when they heard how God came down on this glorious night. God came down on this glorious night. I hear the angels singing, hallelujah, let the earth receive again. Love has come. Sing it out. Jesus Christ is born. Jesus Christ is born. Yeah. Glorious, glorious. What a glorious night. Stars shining in the sky. Below in Bethlehem, the King is sleeping. Oh, what a glorious night. Oh, what a glorious night. Please be seated.
Well, good evening. First check, I didn't say good morning, so that's a wonderful thing. Merry Christmas. So wonderful to have you here worshiping with us this evening, and we're so thrilled that we get to start off our festivities, which hopefully will extend into tomorrow, and who knows how many more family gatherings we have and all that kind of stuff, but hopefully tonight our hope is to focus our eyes on Jesus. Remind ourselves why it is that we celebrate this time of year, and that's kind of our goal. We're recording this service, and we're going to put it online for the 6 o'clock service for those who can't be here tonight. So I just wanted to say a couple of things because I actually have our youngest daughter had a fever this morning, and so my kids are at home. So I said that I would say hi to Quinn and Judah and Harper. We miss you. We love you, and I'll be home soon. And I also wanted to just say hi to the Newdorf family. We had a family from the church who moved out to New Brunswick not that long ago, and I know that they'll be watching as well, so we want to say a Merry Christmas to them. I'm sure there's many of our church family that we might not see tonight, but we're certainly with them in spirit. So we just want to thank you, and as I look out, I see some faces that I don't recognize, so I just really quickly before we jump into our service, we love having kids in the service, and so if you have kids here, just know that we love their wiggles, we love the ambient noise that they bring with them, and so we would just encourage you, stay and enjoy this service as a family. If things get really, you need to take them out for a slight discipline or such, you'll find that there are rooms available. The nursery is open if you want to go in there, and the TV's on in there if you just want to do either grab a toy to come in or just go in out for a quick attitude adjustment, whatever you need to. But please know that we love having families worshiping together here. Make the church your home and any place that you need to be in order to get through the service. We're glad to have you here. That's all we're going to do. I'm going to open us up in prayer, and we're going to start off by reading the Christmas story, okay? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that we get to gather here, and we're so thankful that we can come together and be reminded what this season is all about. And Lord, I imagine that ovens at home are preheating, and there are things in the fridge that are going to be delicious. Somebody, I'm sure, is thinking about something they forgot to take out of the freezer. But in all of those things, Lord, I just pray that there wouldn't be anything that distracts us tonight from having our attention taken and brought to you. We want our eyes fixed on Jesus so that all of our celebration tomorrow and all of the things that we eat and all of the laughs that we have and all of the games that we play and all of the festivities, we want to know and to be reminded that we can enjoy life because we are at peace with our Creator. And that was only possible because you sent Christ 2,000 years ago. And so as we celebrate that, may that get deep into our bones so that it saturates every facet of our celebration tomorrow. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. As I said, we're going to start off by reading the Christmas story. So Heather and I are going to read it, and we're going to kind of read the narrative, and we're going to jump back and forth between Luke and Matthew so we get the full story. So this is the story. This is why we celebrate this time of year. Okay.
In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be, Mary?" asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month, for no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her.
Now the birth of Jesus took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who is born King of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea. For so it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them the time that the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when they have found him, bring me word that I might too come and worship him." After listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star that they had seen when it rose before them, until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy, and going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. That's the Christmas story. That's why we're here celebrating. I would encourage you to stand, and let's sing some carols together.
Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations, rise, join the triumph of the skies. Angelic host proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Next by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord.
Emmanuel, in ransom captive Israel, that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou day spring, come and cheer. Our spirits by thy advent disperse the gloomy clouds of night, in death's dark shadows put to flight. Shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou wisdom from on high, in order all things far and nigh, to us the path of just set our ways to go. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, desire.
Breaks a new and glorious morn.
the light of faith serenely beaming with glorious by his cradle we stand. So led by light of a star sweetly gleaming, you came the wise men from Orient land. The King of Kings lay in a lonely manger in all our trials, born to be a friend. He knows our need, but to our weakness is no stranger. We hold your King.
Praise.
white screen of death means the video won't show. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that 2,000 years ago there was a holy night that you sent your Son into a world that desperately needed a Savior. And Lord, as we come before you this morning, we pray that you would speak to us from your word and give us words of nourishment as we go into our celebration tomorrow. And perhaps now more than ever, after a couple of years of distorted love and distorted understandings of what it looks like to celebrate and to be with family, I pray, Lord, that you would give us a fresh revelation tonight from your word that would remind us how our love ought to look over the next few days as we celebrate. Speak to us from your word, and may your Holy Spirit be here, empowering the words that I speak, but also helping us to hear and to understand and to apply them to our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this Advent season, our church family has been going through this series called Incarnational Love. We hear a lot over the Christmas season, whether it's through Advent candles or through Advent devotionals you do with your family, about peace, hope, joy, and love. And one of the things that we wanted to do over this season is to look at the idea of love, because I think that this time of year has a whole lot to teach us about what love looks like. Here we are, 2 years into a very distorted understanding of what it is that love looks like. 2 years into being told that love looks like staying away, staying distanced, and not going near or celebrating with or sharing life's moments with those who mean the most to us. And I think now, more than any other part of the Christian calendar, ought to remind us that real love looks different than that. We read it tonight that real love is Emmanuel, God with us. What we celebrate at Christmas is the reality that God loved us too much to stay away in a distant, sanitized heaven. He wanted to come into a tainted and dirty world, getting his hands dirty, so to speak, in order to save dirty sinners like us. And so we learn at Christmas time that real love is incarnational. It is present. It is with. It is among. And it's willing to get messy. And that's what we've been looking at over the last little while. And what I want to do tonight is just to kind of frame our minds and calibrate our minds for how we ought to be celebrating over the next couple of days. I don't know how many of you and what your plans will be tomorrow or Boxing Day. I know we have various families, and so maybe some of you will be traveling all over the place. Maybe you'll get a couple big Christmas meals in. I pray that you do. That's a wonderful thing. But even if it's just one big celebration tomorrow, I kind of want to help us get our minds around what it looks like to celebrate. And one of the places I wanted to go in order to help you with your Christmas celebration, to calibrate your minds around the joy and the festivities, is the depressing book of Ecclesiastes. I'm just kidding. It's not really that depressing. But Ecclesiastes, and I'm not going to go through, I'd love to read the whole thing, but I was told I can't preach a full sermon tonight, so people have places to go and turkeys to baste. But the book of Ecclesiastes was written by an old man who was a king, who was a wise king, who was looking back on his life, looking back at the various things that he spent his life doing and the various things that he spent his life building and achieving, and sort of looking back over his life near the end of his life and sort of surveying what it was that he built, what it was that he accomplished. And even if you don't have much in terms of a understanding of Scripture, or you haven't read much of Scripture, this phrase will be familiar to you because it's sort of seeped its way into culture. The phrase that comes to us from Ecclesiastes that we ought to all know is vanity of vanities, right? That doesn't mean a whole lot to us now as we live in 2021, but the word vanity, quite literally, the word that we translate to vanity, literally means a puff of smoke or a vapor. So what the author is saying is smoke, smoke, everything is smoke, or vapor, vapor, everything is vapor. And I think what the author is trying to get at is he looks back at his life, at all of the things that he accomplished. And like I said, he was a king. He was a wealthy king, and he was a wise king, which means that nothing was sort of outside of his grasp in terms of the things that he pursued. So wealth and riches and relationships and food and drink and wisdom and knowledge, all the things that he could have pursued with his life, the work that he did, right? Solomon built the wonderful palace and the wonderful temple to the Lord, right? And we get all of the details of that in Scripture. So Solomon's looking back, and there's much that he could look at in terms of the good things that he accomplished in life. But what we also understand as we know about Solomon and his life is that his sin actually led to the splitting of Israel, that Israel split into the north and south because of Solomon's sin. And so when he's looking back and he's saying, vanity, vanity, all is vanity, what he's saying is smoke, smoke, everything is smoke. Here's what he's getting at. You know how smoke, especially you think of thick smoke, when you're thinking of thick smoke, it might look like it's really there. But if you go to grasp the smoke, if you go to grasp the vapor, the moment you seize it with your hands, it disappears in your hands. And I think the reason Solomon comes back to this phrase over and over again in the book of Ecclesiastes is because he recognizes that he spent most of his life pursuing things that just turned to smoke in his hands. The moment he grasped them, he realized that they weren't substantial enough, they weren't lasting enough, they weren't eternal enough to actually bring the joy and the satisfaction that he sought as an old man looking back at the rest of his life. And so all of the things that he had pursued, the work that he tried to accomplish, the relationships he tried to cultivate, and believe me, if you know your Bible at all, Solomon tried to cultivate a lot of relationships, perhaps too many. But the relationships he tried to cultivate and the food he tried to enjoy and the wisdom he accumulated and the temple that he built, all of these things, he says, is just like smoke. The moment I got them, I realized that they didn't actually satisfy. So how many of you tomorrow, let me just talk to the kids for a second, all the kids in here, how many of you are really excited for tomorrow? Like, I got one hand before, I know what you're going to be asking. I know what you're going to be asking. All right, keep your hands up, kids, because I want to show you something really cool. How many adults are really excited for tomorrow? So see, that's something that you're not going to grow out of. Isn't that fun? Isn't that cool? Okay, how many of you are really looking forward to, how many of you are thinking about, there's one thing that you really hope is under that tree? Yeah? How many of you are looking forward to chocolate? How many of you are looking forward to spending time with loved ones? How many of you are looking forward to turkey? Ham. Some people raise their hands for both turkey and ham, so I want an invite to your Christmas next year. That's fantastic. Well done. There's a lot of things that we are going to enjoy tomorrow. There's a lot of things that we're going to enjoy over the festivities of the next couple of days, and those are good things. But as Solomon looked back at all of the stuff he had accumulated, and like I said, as a king, nothing was sort of outside of his reach in terms of what he wanted to pursue, he realized that all of those things that we're going to enjoy tomorrow, the gifts that we'll give and we'll receive, the relationships that we'll enjoy, the turkey that we'll eat, the chocolate that we eat, the drink, the wine that we drink, whatever it is, tomorrow we're going to discover all of these wonderful things. But Solomon, at the end of his life, was looking back and realizing that all of that was just vanity. Have a joyful Christmas tomorrow. That's all I can. No, I'm just kidding. Just kidding. See, thank you. Here's the big idea I want us to grasp. The incarnation actually, if you just want to flip that for me, whoever has control of that. So the incarnation promises hope to a world that is hopeless without Jesus. The incarnation promises hope to the world that is hopeless without Jesus. Solomon gets to this really neat place in Ecclesiastes, and so I just kind of summarized a lot of his meanderings in the first several chapters as he goes through and thinks about all the things that he did. But in Ecclesiastes chapter 9, there's these cool verses. It's verses 7 and 8. And Ecclesiastes chapter 9, 7 and 8 go like this. Go and eat your bread with joy and drink your wine with a merry heart, for God has already approved what you do. Now, before I read the next verse, I want to read that again. Some of your translations that I think are actually a better translation of this, some of your translations, instead of saying God has already approved of what you do, it actually says God has already approved of your works. Okay, so the New King James, the King James Version, the NASB, they translate it that way. So I'm just going to say it that way, even though I'm reading out of the ESV, and I'm going to read verses 7 and 8 together. Go and eat your bread with joy, and drink your wine with a merry heart, for God has already approved your works. Let your garments always be white, let not oil be lacking on your head. Now, this language that Solomon is using, right? May your garments always be white. May there always be oil for your head. And then even this language of God has already accepted your works. That's salvific language. When we read through the Bible, a lot of times in the Old Testament, it promises that God is going to change our filthy robes for pure white robes, white garments, or that he's going to put an oil of gladness on our heads. He's going to anoint us. This is language often in the Old Testament that's used to promise the new covenant, that promises the reality that one day we'll be able to be right with God again. And so this language that Solomon is using is looking forward to a time when God's people are given clean robes, oil for their heads, when God has accepted their works. And so it's interesting when you think about it that way. What Solomon is driving at, and this is really important, so I want you to think about this. What Solomon is driving at is kind of saying there's a lot of really wonderful things for us to enjoy in life. One of the metaphors that Scripture always comes back to is that as sweet as honey, right? He uses that to talk about God's law, about God's word, about God's presence, as sweet as honey. Well, what Solomon's sort of driving at is that if there are things in life like honey that's sweet and enjoyable, then relationship with God is what gives you taste buds to taste the honey. What he's saying is that all of these things, right, he says, go and eat your bread with joy, drink your wine with a merry heart. And he's coming to that after he's already said that all of the bread and all of the wine in the world is nothing but vanity, nothing but smoke. When you chase it, when you grasp it, it's nothing. And then he goes out to tell you, and he says, now go and drink your wine with joy, go and eat your bread with a merry heart. Well, that seems to contradict. And what I think he's getting at is once God accepts your works, once God gives you white garments, once God gives you oil for your head, in other words, once you are in right relationship with God, it's like you have the taste buds to enjoy all of the good things in life. And so suddenly, the turkey you're going to enjoy tomorrow, the gifts that you're going to give and receive tomorrow, the relationships that you're going to cultivate tomorrow, all of the festivities that we love about these kinds of times of year, unless we're given the taste buds to truly enjoy them, they just turn to vapor in our hands. God is what gives life meaning. And so the incarnation promises hope to the world that was hopeless without Jesus. And there's sort of three things that I think, three ways in which Jesus brings hope to a world that's hopeless without him. Okay, so the first one, you can click through these for me. The first one is this. Without Jesus, the difficulties of life are meaningless. Without Jesus, the difficulties of life are meaningless. Now this is really interesting. So it's important for us to know who it is that we're celebrating tomorrow. Colossians chapter 1 has sort of the most concise text that tells us who Jesus actually is. Like, whose birthday is it that we're celebrating tomorrow? Colossians 1 says it this way, starting in verse 15. It says, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation." So Jesus is the visible image of the invisible God. He is the one who shows us what God is like. He's the one who shows us what God's love looks like, what God's hate looks like, what God does, what he involves himself in, what he's like. "For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning of the firstborn of the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross." And so what that's telling us is that Jesus was actively involved in the entire creation of the world, that all things were made for him, and he sustains all things. The Bible has a really succinct word for all of that. It's called sovereignty. That God is sovereign, that Christ is sovereign. It means that he's in control of everything. It means that everything that happens in the world goes according to his plan. Only one who is sovereign, only the one who sustains all things, only the one who wills all things is sovereign. And I'll tell you why that's important, because in this world, we all have all kinds of heartaches. In fact, when I'm talking about festivities and family that we're all going to gather with tomorrow, there are some people who are here tonight whose hearts sink a little bit because this time of year is really hard for them. Why? Because there's broken relationships in their family, because of divorce, because of all kinds, loss of family members, burying children. There's all kinds of reasons why this time of year is difficult for people. And in this world, we will all face difficulty. And the worldview that everybody outside would tell you is that we are just protoplasm bobbing on the surface of the cosmos, oftentimes just sort of banging into other protoplasm. That this is all just a random accident, and if it's a random accident, then your lot in life is either the result of good luck or bad luck. The difficult things that you go through just happen to happen to you and not to somebody else because of cosmic chance. To me, there's nothing more depressing than that thought. But because God is sovereign, because somebody created the world, because God sent his son into the world, and we know that he is sovereign, all of the difficulty that we go through is not meaningless, and it's not by accident. There is a good and a loving God who stands behind all of even the difficult things of life, and he's the one who in Romans 8:28 promises, all things will work together for the good of those who love me and who are called according to my purposes. In other words, all things, even the difficulty of life. And this is authored by the one whose son was murdered on the cross 30 years after the night that we celebrate. All things work together for our good and for God's glory. The only way that is possible is if God is sovereign. And so Jesus, the sovereign one, the one who holds all things together and sustains all things, actually gives meaning to life's difficulties. And that's what helps us get through it. We sang it tonight in O Holy Night. The line is, he knows our... I'm going to get it wrong here. He knows our needs. Thank you for whoever said that. He knows our needs. To our weakness is no stranger. He came into this dark world. He came in and experienced all of the things that we experience. He experienced heartache and turmoil and trouble and difficulty, unjust treatment, the loss of family members. He endured all of that. And all of it culminated to him on the cross, which is our ultimate good and his ultimate glory. And so if Jesus hadn't have come into the world, if the incarnation wasn't true, without Jesus, the difficulties of life are meaningless. Beyond that, though, without Jesus, there's no ultimate purpose or direction in life. Without Jesus, there's no ultimate purpose or direction in life. So as Solomon is looking back at all of the things that he accomplished, and he's saying it's all vapor, it's all smoke, it's all meaningless, he's saying that because he was building his own empire, his own life, his own storehouses full of goods. What Solomon recognized afterwards is unless you're doing something, unless you're attaching yourself to God's story, no matter what it is that you build with your life, it all becomes meaningless. There's a really depressing line. I'm sorry, I feel like I'm being very depressing tonight, but I promise it's all going to end very joyfully. There's this really depressing line in a movie called About Schmidt where he says, when you die and everybody who knew you die, it's like you never existed. And I thought, ooh, watch that when I was young. It was sort of a gut check to me because what it made me realize is you can work as hard as you want to build things that last. There's only one thing that the Bible says will last forever, and that is the kingdom of God. And so unless your life is about building the kingdom of God, about attaching yourself to his ultimate story, then whatever it is that we build here in life will ultimately unravel. We've seen it, right? We've seen somebody build some great, incredible business that helps all kinds of people, only to see his children fight over the fortune. Or one of his children inherit that and take it in a completely different direction. We've seen these things. It doesn't matter what you build here on earth. Unless your hands are put to the task of building God's kingdom, it's vanity, vanity, smoke, and vapor. The third thing is this, is without Jesus, there's no hope for life beyond death. Without Jesus, there's no hope for life beyond death. What Solomon ultimately realizes is that life under the sun can be full of difficulty and toil, but life in the Son to come, is where we find purpose and meaning. Without Jesus, there's no hope for life beyond death. You know, this is exactly why this Christmas and last Christmas, and unless things change, next Christmas, are so weird, right? People not gathering, people not sure whether or not they can be with family, families asking about status and how big your bubble is and all this sort of weird stuff that goes on for these last couple of Christmases. It's weird and it's inhuman. It's not how we were created to design. You know why? It's because without Jesus, there is a paralyzing fear of death. Because death is the end. Death is the great unknown. There's nothing beyond death. But you know, Hebrews 2 actually tells us that because Jesus passed from death to life, that he liberated all of us from the fear of death. And so Christians ought to live life liberated from the fear of death. This is why Paul could say, to live is Christ, to die is gain. And so, at Christmas time, we are reminded that Jesus came into the world, into this dark, dirty world, to find dark, dirty sinners like us, to save us, to bring us back into relationship with him. And the thing about the incarnation, and this is what you ought to remember tomorrow as you read the Christmas story, as you have your nativity scene out, as you watch whatever movies you have that have nativities in it, is be reminded that that child in the manger ends up as the man who's on the cross. The purpose of Bethlehem was Calvary. The purpose of the manger was the cross. That man died on the cross in order to bring you back into relationship with him. We can have meaning in life. We can see purpose even in our difficulties. And we can have a hope for life beyond death because Jesus was born a baby in a manger, but he lived a perfect sinless life and died as a righteous one in our place on the cross. And so Christmas finds all of its meaning and all of the traditions that we enjoy and all of the festivities that we will enjoy tomorrow all find their ultimate purpose because we can look through the turkey, through the gifts, through the family, through the fellowship at the one who gifted it all to us and who gave us taste buds to actually enjoy it. And so tomorrow, for those who are in Christ, the turkey, the fellowship, the celebration is all eternal because it's a dress rehearsal for eternity. That's what it's going to look like in eternity as we feast. There's a reason the Bible calls the great day the wedding feast. We will be feasting and celebrating like it's Christmas all year round. And the reason we can do that is because we recognize not just the gifts, but the great gift giver who gives us taste buds to enjoy it all. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you. We're so thankful that you've given us eyes to see and ears to hear. For anybody who's here tonight who has not been given the taste buds to truly enjoy, we pray, Lord, that tonight you would give them a soft heart, that tonight they would recognize their need to trust in Jesus, the one who gives hope to a hopeless world. I pray for everybody who's here tonight, Lord. May our celebration be full of joy, be full of presence with a C, be full of your grace and joy as we enjoy one another and we practice for eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
While you stand, we're going to sing a couple more songs together.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing.
Songs employ while fields and floods, rocks, hills. joy.
Has come to
Merry Christmas, everybody. I hope you have a wonderful day celebrating tomorrow. I'm going to leave you by reading from God's Word, but first I want to encourage you with some words from another of my favorite authors, C.S. Lewis, who said, "Never let the white witch steal Christmas from you." So go and celebrate tomorrow, and with the words of Solomon, "Go and eat your bread with joy and drink your wine with a merry heart, for God has already accepted your works. Let your garments be always white, let not oil be lacking your head." May the Lord be with you. Merry Christmas.